Charles Birnbaum and Sarah Newbury have entitled the opening session Foundations and invited six landscape architects to speak about the Houston public space designs each has completed or been associated with. Hermann Park's main access from the Sam Houston Monument to the Houston Zoo entrance by Olin and the SWA Group, and the park's McGovern Centennial Gardens by Hairshout and White Oak Studio. The first phase of the Buffalo Bayou Park improvements, the Sabine to Bagby Promenade by SWA Group, Discovery Green by Hargraves Associates, and the landscape setting for the Brockstein Pavilion at Rice University by the Office of James Burnett, stand out as 21st century public spaces of extraordinary quality. There, the planning, design, and detailing of both planted and constructed elements shape Houston landscapes that elevate and enhance the experiences of those who occupy them. In a city, as we've heard from Charles, whose name has become synonymous with environmental exploitation and degradation, Houstonization, the inspiring quality of these public spaces is amazing. In this session and those that follow, we will hear from the landscape architects most closely associated with bringing these places into being. They will describe how factors of nature and culture affected their design decisions, how their works make connections between natural phenomena and systems of use, how private philanthropy and public authority combined to support formation of these landscapes, and how each landscape architect assesses their design work. In preliminary conversations that Charles and Sarah had with participants in each session, a number of critical points emerged. Sarah Newberry observed that with Hermann Park and Buffalo Bayou Park, we are looking not at new places, but at existing public spaces. Hermann Park is 100 years old and Buffalo Bayou Park 90 years old, that have leapt back into our collective consciousness because of the quality of the design work done there. As Sarah summarized it, once we understand that we are dealing with historical cycles, we more clearly perceive that these are enduring places. They demonstrate the value of the initial investments made in acquiring and improving them, as well as the investments made in their renewal and enhancement. Hargraves' design work at Discovery Green, a completely new public landscape space, also bears out Sarah Newberry's observations linking value and appreciation. Mayor Bill White's unorthodox approach to commissioning, paying for, and then managing Discovery Green, not as a Houston City Park, but as a publicly accessible green space built on city-owned property, paid for largely by private philanthropy, and administered and programmed by a nonprofit organization rather than by the city's Parks and Recreation Department, has worked smoothly because the quality of both the design and the management, as well as the public's enthusiastic response, have created a consensus that Discovery Green is a success. In our conversations, Matthew Urbanski of Michael Van Valkenburgh Associates noted that in contrast to many of the American cities where he has worked, there appears to be no formula for public consultation in Houston. As long as public-private ventures produce well-received public spaces, Houston's lack of a formal consultation process will not be controversial. But when design decisions are called into question, the weak public planning process in Houston becomes evident. The controversy over cladding the basin of the Mecum Fountain in Hermann Park speaks to the lack of public consultation, design review, and historic, natural, and constructed resource surveys, all attributable to the City of Houston's lack of processes for public planning. This deficiency puts nonprofit advocacy, planning, and management organizations in the uncomfortable position of having to compensate for the city's lack of direction. Moreover, because they depend on authorization and sometimes funding from public agencies, Houston's pro-public nonprofits may feel compelled to not criticize or indeed defend controversial projects, such as the Harris County Flood Control District's proposal to rechannel Buffalo Bayou in Memorial Park, destroying the least disturbed stretch of bayou riparian forest remaining in Houston. I mention these controversies so that as we praise the achievements of pro-public nonprofits and their design consultants, we not overlook procedural weaknesses that can call into question Houston's reliance on nonprofits to undertake work that underfunded public agencies are not capable of performing without external direction and support. The issue of the equitable distribution of resources, which public agencies must also acknowledge, is another point of vulnerability. As philanthropists focus on retrieving Houston's most conspicuous public spaces. In our conversation, Scott McCready spoke about SWA's work in redesigning Buffalo Bayou Park to make it more accessible, attract a broader constituency, educate those who come to the park about nature, the bayou, riparian corridors, and the challenges of intervening in a floodway. Scott's observations about the challenge of designing what he describes as a resilient public space capable of withstanding frequent flooding touches on what he sees as an unavoidable conflict between expectations for static park improvements and the reality of dynamic ecological cycles. The tension between nature as unpredictable process and nature as a scenic picture is also played out in a different way in Mary Margaret Jones's design for Hargraves of Discovery Green. Prior to Hargraves becoming involved, the Project for Public Spaces conducted a public consultation and planning process to program activities in Discovery Green. From my perspective, the Discovery Green Conservancy's programming of activities is what distinguishes this public space from other downtown parks, some of which have since been spatially reorganized and programmed in emulation of Discovery Green. Our conversations made it clear that landscape architects have reservations about this embrace of public space programming, and I trust we will hear more about what designers see as its limitations. The tension between existing and envisioned can also be sensed at the Menil Collection, where Jack Oley and Van Valkenburgh were tested, in true Houston fashion, by first being asked to redesign the museum's parking lot. Intervening in a purposefully non-designed landscape, that for the museum's founder, Dominique de Menil, was a layering of elusive traces of the site's prior suburban history, poses questions about the limits of design. Yet, as Matthew Urbanski indicated in our conversations, and as Discovery Green, Buffalo Bayou Park, Hermann Park, and the Brockstein Pavilion demonstrate, it is often only after public space improvements have been installed that people can really see and appreciate the extraordinary transformations that outstanding landscape architecture can achieve. Charles Birnbaum has discerned that we are experiencing the emergence of a Houston collection as both internationally recognized and locally based landscape architects formulate a new landscape vision for Houston. We can be grateful that the Cultural Landscape Foundation has given us this opportunity to become aware of and reflect on what this investment in talent can mean for making public space in Houston more equitable, accessible, connected, inclusive, sustainable, beautiful, innovative, and inspiring.